Welcome to All Talk, the Geekbox Forums Community Podcast. This is episode 7 for the week of March 19th. I am Mark, aka Dakazoo, from the forums, and who is with me?
I am David, aka DarkFox8, from the forums.
I am Jake, aka Mr. X.
And I am Andrew, aka Totoro.
Hi, everybody.
Hello.
Hi, is that a big secret? Is everybody shocked that I'm David?
No.
I did not see that coming, but it suits you.
I thought you were Goliath.
Well, I'm giant, so.
I think Drew thought you were Geraldo.
No, that was me.
That was Jake that thought you were Geraldo?
Yep. A bunch of Latino names you could have come up with.
Geraldo.
Yeah, let's welcome David back. He was on the second episode. Welcome back.
Yep. David, back.
Oh, thank you. I'm happy to be back. I'm jealous that Kenzo got to be 2 times in a row. I was like, he was the guy who didn't want to be on the podcast, and he ended up being a bunch, and he was good. I think we should congratulate him.
You should tell him that, David, because he likes you. And last time I talked to him, he did not like listening to himself, which I understand.
Right, that's always awkward, but he was good. Like, he had jokes and shit, you know?
Jokes?
I think he called you the saddest sack, which was funny.
The saddest sack? He did, yes, because I saved up for the Jaguar CD.
Yeah, that was funny.
Indeed.
Me and my brother getting a Sega CD. We got that, I think that was the same summer, like within the same 6-month period that we got the first PlayStation.
You know, we should just continue talking about how great we are on the podcast.
Yeah.
For 2 hours.
We do want to talk that we have just put up on the forums our spinoff on our Twin Peaks cast.
We have.
Yeah, you got some newcomers to Twin Peaks, and you got some people who haven't seen it before, right? But everybody's watching it again, right?
Yes,
for the first time.
But unfortunately, it doesn't have the Log Lady intros.
Yeah, that was kind of disappointing.
But there's ways around that. They're on YouTube. We can embed them in the threads and whatever, so people can check those out.
I actually haven't seen them because those came when it was in syndication, right?
So no, I think it was original airing.
Oh, really? I'd read that was in syndication. I think when it's changed channels, stations, but either way, I haven't seen them, so I should go to YouTube and watch a bunch of them, or all of them.
You could.
Yeah, we'll post them kind of as we go, and I think one of the things that, you know, I kind of asked on the forums thread was, we're kind of fine with spoilers, just so long as it's only up to kind of as far as we've gotten in our discussion.
Yeah, don't spoil ahead.
I'm purposely not going to look at that thread, I think, just to save myself in case.
And because you've said that, watch out for PMs from Troll, because Troll likes spoiling things.
Oh, man. He would spoil the end of anything.
Well, really?
Troll on the forums.
I never saw his post about Game of Thrones. I only saw the thread afterwards when it was edited, and I know the fallout was like 3 pages. But from what I understand, he just posted like bullet list of important things that happened in the series up to now.
Yeah, and then when they talked about it on the Geekbox, in that thread, he went in there and spoiled Karen on Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
Wow, what a dick.
So what do you guys feel is like a statute of limitations? Like, at what point can you spoil something?
You can spoil someone if someone gives you consensus to spoil. Done.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's like at a certain point, it's like, you know, if you haven't seen Citizen Kane, you know.
Well, if you know someone is about to watch Citizen Kane, don't just be like, oh, yeah, the sled.
But also the person who is trying to keep themselves spoiler-free should, you know, try to avoid them at all costs. Like, that's also responsibility on that person.
Yeah, but sometimes it's unavoidable. Someone just walk up to you and say, Darth Vader is Luke's father.
Whoa.
But it depends on the age of the movie or the game, but also like the cultural impact. If there's a bunch of parodies and movies parodying that, then that's safer to spoil because through osmosis, you know, you get that stuff.
Yeah.
Right.
But if it's some like indie thing that no one has played or watched, even if it's old, you should probably try not to spoil it.
You know, this is a good transition. Sorry, Drew. Did you want to comment?
I think the only thing I was going to say was, you know, but I feel like certain mediums kind of lend themselves to being spoiled less or being spoiled more. It's like, you know, it may take someone a longer time to play a game, but, you know, within the course of, you know, if you haven't watched a TV show or episode within, you know, a month, you know, or something of when it came out.
So I could spoil like Buffy for you right now, and it'd be cool.
Well, if you knew, I think that kind of goes back to the, you know, if you knew that I had no intention of watching it.
Right.
Which I kind of do. In fact, that may be like the next show that I start up on my own.
It's a good show.
Let's talk about something I don't want to spoil for any of you. I just played a game called Dear Escher last night, and I want to talk about it.
Is this like M.C. Escher?
Yeah, it's about weird paintings and stuff.
Yeah. Backward letters and
this
stuff.
This is something that's more akin to Flower, game on PlayStation Network.
Okay, here's what I know about
the game. I heard it mentioned on the Bombcast, so...
Here's what I know about the game. Tell me if I'm right. It's like a game where you're just like traversing an environment and like discovering things, and that's telling you the story, but there's no real like gameplay or anything to it.
Yes. Basically, to just quickly sum up things, because I don't want to ruin things, is that you are on an island and you traverse around the island, and there's narration that gives you backstory as you walk around and explore. But all you do is traverse. That's all you do. And it's short. You finish it in about an hour.
Is this by that game company, or...?
It is not.
You're thinking of Journey. Okay.
Is this okay. Indie or something? Is this like a mod? Is it done by just people, or is it a company, a video game company that puts out games?
It was a mod by, I forget the group off the top of my head. I'll look it up while we talk. But it was originally a mod, and then they worked on a commercial release, which they just released in February. And,
it was a Half-Life 2 mod, and then they ported it to the Portal 2 engine, is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, seriously? Okay, well, I was going to say, well, it's a Half-Life mod, because there are so many
games
out there that are Half-Life and Half-Life 2 and Source mods.
Well, yeah, they overhauled the graphics.
About the production value. When you say narration, is there actually talking? Is there good voice acting, stuff like that?
There's a narrator, and it is well done. The narration is well done. Just like in general, yeah, I want to talk about this game because there was a lot of thought put into this. And from everything from like the environment, the way you traverse, how things look, the music that goes with it, like everything is done with a purpose to make you feel something.
So what you're saying is this game is art.
What I'm saying is this, like Flower, I feel does not fall in the category of games. It is a new kind of subgenre that doesn't even have a name right now.
Interactive
it has a
something?
Purpose beyond... As a purpose beyond just, you know, giving you more levels and more power-ups and stuff like that.
Well, it's difficult. Like I said, it's kind of a new subgenre, and I would put Flower in here as well. And I don't want to call it interactive fiction, because that could, like, it's not like choose your own adventure books. Like, you could technically call that interactive fiction. This is its own
to
genre.
Me that would be, yeah, to me, that would, like, interactive fiction would almost be something like Heavy Rain.
Like, playing through this game, in quotes, I definitely felt something. Like, I had an emotional response to everything that I went through. And it was very well planned. And like I said, it was very well thought of and put together to invoke this kind of emotional response.
Well, that's kind of... So is it just the way everything comes together and the storytelling... Or is it, you know, primarily the storytelling that evokes that emotional response?
Or, it's everything, you know, come together. Okay. I don't want to say, okay. I don't want to give specifics. I know it's $10 off of Steam right now, and it's kind of hard to say. I was thinking to myself, do I justify the cost of this? Because
I was just gonna ask if you thought it was worth $10.
It's as a, if you look at it as like a game, then probably not. But if you look at it as an experience, I say $10 is well worth the price. So it's hard to say. I definitely think it's worth playing through. But it's going to be like really...
PC.
It's going to be hard for people to decide whether what their, you know, monetary value of this is.
Yeah, that's very relative.
Yeah, I know. But and for me, I can say that this game was a gift from my friend Cheese Bill. He gave it to me. And
I love Cheese Bill.
Is that his given name, Cheese Bill?
No, I just call him... His name is Bill, but I just call him Cheese Bill because he likes fancy cheese.
Well, who doesn't like fancy cheese?
Well,
so you're saying like the closest game you can think of to this is Flower?
Yes. Have you guys played Flower?
I have. I enjoyed it.
I've seen plenty of video of it, so I generally understand the mechanics, but I never played through the experience of
it. So this is an important factor. David says he hasn't played it. Jake, you said you played it.
Yep.
Jake, would you agree with me that you think if you haven't played through the entirety of Flower, it does not compare to just watching Flower?
Yes. Because it tells a story, sort of, in a way, that you don't get until you've played through all of it.
Yeah,
and
I think I've not...
the gameplay is just, you have to play it. It's not something you can watch.
There's a specific experience that you get from playing through Flower as opposed to just watching it.
Yes, definitely. Yeah. Especially because you're not going to watch the whole thing being played.
Although that's what I'm talking about. That's exactly the type of feeling I got playing through Dear Escher. Well, not the same emotions, but just the same type of experience. It was kind of, you had to do it.
I hear Journey is the same way.
Same company, though. The same company did Flower, right?
That company.
Yeah.
That game company.
Only it's supposed to be more video game-like, but it sounds really cool. I think I'm going to check that out.
So I feel like I said at the beginning, it's hard to categorize it as a game. It's kind of its own genre, these types of games, these things.
So you're saying an art game can't be both art and a game? It has to be one or the other? Is that what was that what you're getting at?
Because I'm saying these fall under their own specific category. Flower and Dear Escher fall under their own category. We can talk a little about like art and video games if you want. Like I know a lot of people bring up Shadow of the Colossus and Ico and all those other things.
I would bring up newer games though, like Bastion and Portal.
See, I don't know. The old Ico games, like Ico and Shadow of Colossus, those games are really, really cool and really, really crafted, but they never really blew me away. Like, I never got moved emotionally through it.
Yeah, same
for me. I don't know if I'm alone in that. They're definitely elaborate. Like, the way they look and the way, you know, outside of the frame rate and technology, the way everything kind of comes together visually and stuff like that, it is elaborate and it is, I guess, crafted. And I'm fine with calling it art, but I'm not part of the club that splooged their pants when they first, you know, played the game.
There are definitely, like, emotional responses and things that you get from that game, like Shadow of the Colossus and Ico, but it's a game, you know. It's just well put together, like you said, David.
Well, it's like, you know, I don't think that I've had games that have made me kind of angry about the situation, not like because of, you know, the controls seemed, you know, off or, you know, what have you, but, you know, actually where I wanted to continue to fight on because of, you know, some struggle that the characters were going through.
Something like Metal Gear Solid 4? Like there's this hallway in it?
Yeah, it has a famous section at the end where it's like this epic conclusion where every single good guy character is battling, seemingly a losing battle, and Snake has to crawl down this hallway that's full of microwaves. It's supposed to be like the security measure for him not to get to like the Holy Grail or whatever. And they make you mash the button, and it's supposed to be, because they make you mash the button like a lot, so your arm gets really tired.
Yeah, pretty, really tired, so you're actually painful. Feeling the pain that he is feeling.
It's supposed to be analogous to what all the characters are feeling at the same time, and it has a pretty cool split screen to what the characters are struggling, and definitely it's a cool thing, but it's pretty simple, actually.
It's just
mashing a button, right? Yeah.
But it's effective.
Right, but where I was going with that though, was, you know, games have made me feel certain emotions, but I don't know that a game has ever made me cry tears of joy or tears of sadness or, you know, anything to kind of that degree.
Have you played Flower?
Yes.
You played through it.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
what
that
is
didn't make me cry?
What is your thoughts? I'm not saying like Flower made me cry, but what did you do? You understand what I'm saying when I say like. You get an emotional response through Flower, and how it's in a different category than, say, Metal Gear Solid 4, where you're experiencing
I get where you're coming from there, but what I'm saying is that, you know, kind of in the history of, you know, film and the history of, you know, other art forms, the whole point of art is to produce some sort of cathartic reaction.
An emotion. It doesn't have to be a specific emotion. Well, and it doesn't have to be the same emotion in everyone. It's all up to the interpretation.
No. Right. Well, and that's what I'm. But I'm saying that I've, you know, if the, you know, I've never had, you know, that complete wide range of emotions is kind of what I'm getting at, without sounding overly pretentious about the whole thing.
Well, I would say that Portal makes you feel emotions. I mean, humor, that's an emotion.
Sure, but when you get to that point, like, is Dumb and Dumber high art because it makes you feel a lot of the emotion of humor because you laugh a lot?
Well, it's a different type of humor.
See, that's not the type of emotion I'm talking about. I'm talking specifically for this game, Dear Escher, and for games like Flower. Like, they're in a separate category with the way, like, they make you feel emotions.
Those games are specifically crafted to deliver that emotion and that experience, and they don't have to worry about padding the experience with, you know, more levels or more cutscenes or multiplayer sections and stuff like that.
What about Pride? Has any game ever made you feel pride while playing it?
Maybe simple games, like when you beat the boss, like Mega Man, you feel proud of yourself. But as far as like the story connection, it's hard for me to opinionate whether I feel prideful like playing Metal Gear when I beat the last boss. Like, I feel like I'm well.
Well, if you go through like Metal Gear where you don't alert any guards or anything, I'm sure that gives you something.
Yeah. In that same sense, like as a gamer achievement, I do feel pride all the time playing games.
Well, I think that's kind of like achievements are almost some sort of artificial pride, but you know, kind of keeping. Actually something that like rewards me like in the game. Kind of, I think I know where Jake was trying to lead us a little bit, going back to something like Portal, where you know you feel proud and you feel smart. You know, sometimes when you go through and you solve a puzzle or something, and you feel better about it, and it's like. You just, even though it's so, can be so obvious, you feel smarter because you did.
See, but in Portal 1, in Portal 1, you're solving all these test chambers, right? And at the end of the game, you solve a test chamber that you weren't supposed to solve because you escaped your death, right? And that's like an extra layer on it because it's almost like you're fighting against the system, the norm of the game. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, when my brother was playing through, my brother was playing through Portal the first time, and you're on that little conveyor belt, that platform that's bringing you to the fire.
Going to the fire.
My brother didn't realize that you were supposed to jump off, so he just stood there and then died.
Yeah, because it's kind of meta that way. You weren't expecting it.
Yeah, you had to put it together yourself that you were supposed to escape, because up until that point, you were just listening.
Well, and I think there are just baser emotions that I think Mark is trying to get at, but that
so you know, sadness you get those emotions. And joy? Are those
no,
the two?
What I'm trying to say is, I'm it's not so much about the emotions themselves, it's just that what you're talking about in Portal is something in the context of a game, like feeling pride and like being satisfied that you solved the puzzle. And Metal Gear Solid 4, you know, feeling like the pain of like the characters and the snake and the struggle as he's going through that final section.
Well, in Portal, I was more talking about the humor in it.
Well, yeah,
as the emotion.
Yeah, but like those are all within the context of the game. Like Shadow of the Colossus, the emotions you feel as you're, you know, as you're doing the final sequence. Same with Ico, stuff like that. Those are all within the context of a game, right? Like you're just doing all these like actions and things like that. With Dear Escher. Like you said at the very beginning, Jake, it's traversal. There's nothing else.
Right.
And it's just, you just kind of experience it.
Well, Flower had a point. I mean, it wasn't just pure traversal. I mean, you had to go through all those, like, the windmills and everything.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true,
but there was a goal. But it sounds like in this, there's no real goal. Is there puzzles or anything in Dear Escher?
No.
It's just walking.
It is straight traversal.
Okay.
That's basically, it's just like I said, I have a hard time calling it a game because it's like it's in its own category. It's an experience.
You know, there's a game that's brought up a lot when people talk about games as art. I have never played it, but have you guys ever played Marriage? I believe it's called The Marriage.
No, I know of it. It's interesting. Those are another league. Those are like the arts as system, where there's like these abstract... like avatars you play as, and by interacting with like the game, certain things happen, and that's supposed to be the art. You're supposed to get messages from the way these abstract things act.
Right, but no one's played it.
I no. played the there's another game. I think it was Rob Humble's Life or something like that.
Yeah,
the one the Passage. Like the Passage.
Passage.
The
Passage. Yeah, yeah, that's another one. Yeah,
Which is very similar, I would say, to Dear Escher. If you can find The Passage and you can download it and play it for free, and it's the same thing. Like, I don't know if people are all, if everyone is going to get like the same kind of emotional response, but that's the type of thing you just experience it.
Right.
So, I don't know. It's basically, I would be interested to have Drew play through Dear Escher and tell me what you think.
I think I will, you know, just listening to the way you're talking about it, Mark.
I wish I could say more about it, but I don't want to ruin anything. Like, I can't even talk about what emotions I felt, right, because that's going to ruin, like, things that I, like, experienced.
Right. Well, and that's something I'll get to hopefully here within the next couple months. I mean, you know, I'm going to be able to start, you know, getting games again here pretty soon.
One thing I can say about that game is, or the experience, I'm just going to call it experience. One thing I can say about the experience of Dear Escher, it looks amazing. Like, they did some great work with, like, the environment. And considering that's
that engine looks great.
Yeah, and considering that's a major part of that experience, like, it looks fantastic. And the music is real nice, too.
And this is all on, is it Steam?
Yes, it is currently available on Steam, I believe, for $10.
Okay. And like, but you're saying, if you're looking for a game, it's not really worth it, but if you're looking for an experience, it is?
Yeah, that's where I have a hard time drawing the line, because as a game, like, man, I would not be happy. Like, I see a lot of reviews and, like, comments about people being pissed off and, like, they're, like, rip-off and whatever. But as an experience, I can totally see it being worth, like, $10.
Well, to me, it's like, you know, I can pay $10 and go down to the Megaplex and watch a movie that's not very fulfilling for, and is only like an hour and a half long. So, I mean, $10
for true. A... And this you'll be able to experience over and over.
Yeah, exactly.
I'd be interested to see what you guys would think about after it's seen. I'm glad I brought it up today with just me being the one who experienced it, though.
Yeah, I would definitely want to, you've piqued my interest, and, you know, between that and then obviously Journey, that sounds, you know,
really, I really want to play Journey. Well, I wish I played it before this, then I could have something else to talk about. But David, I'm glad you, wait, was it Jake? You brought up The Passage and Marriage?
Yeah, the Marriage, yeah.
Oh, The Marriage.
Yeah, I think that fits within the same context. Basically, to sum it up, I'm just saying, like, this is a new subgenre that you...
So how long would you say it is?
It takes about an hour to go through.
Okay.
But yeah, I guess that's a cool little subgenre thing that you're doing.
Yep. We can move on from here.
Yeah, it's hard to define it now.
Speedruns?
David, you've been watching speedruns. That's all you watch.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, basically, sometimes I kind of... Before I go to bed, I might watch a few hours of speedruns. Like, on my PS3, I'm looking at my list of videos, and I have Super Mario RPG, I have Assassin's Creed 2, I have a Braid speedrun, a Metal Solid 3, and honestly, I find them almost fascinating, because, like, the way they pick apart these games, like, it seems as though they know them better than the actual people who made the games. It's kind of crazy, and it makes sense, because some of these games have been out for, like, a decade, like Ocarina of Time, games like that. So they've had enough time to pick them apart, but it's in my opinion, it's like the closest thing to like emergent gameplay, because they find these glitches and these bugs, and they use those bugs to play the game more efficiently. It's crazy, and sometimes they combo glitches. Like, I could explain a bunch of them, but
I
don't know how interested you guys are.
I've seen a bunch of speedruns. I haven't seen them in a couple years now, but I had a period where I was watching a ton of speedruns, and they would differentiate the speedruns with, you know, oh, I use this certain glitch on this speedrun. Mm-hmm. Like, this is a non-glitch speedrun. This is a, you know, a full of glitches speedrun. This is a speedrun that's broken up into parts. This is a full run speedrun.
Yeah, segmented and single segment is what they call it. And there's also a difference between tool-assisted runs, which are runs on emulators, because those speedruns, you could basically pause the game and do save states, and those runs are generally perfect. Generally, they are, like, frame perfect, because you could try an infinite amount of times with the save states and stuff like that. There's a website, speeddemosarchive.com, and those deal with like the legit speed runs on the console. They're recorded with like DVD recorders on with like the actual console, and those are like really impressive, because if you see them playing like a really long segment, doing these super skillful jumps and dodging everything, then they actually did
Yeah,
that,
it's really impressive.
they weren't cheating or save stating.
You know,
Yeah.
speed runs sounds like a bad case of diarrhea.
That's what it was. Okay.
Oh,
You know, I didn't. I was expecting something about sex, but you
Oh, just to clarify,
I
before
didn't.
we start recording, Jake was like, "I'm gonna make a joke and I'm gonna make Mark groan." Congratulations.
Yeah. Actually, that was pretty good because I was expecting sex and it went in another direction. It went potty humor, which I always appreciate.
Thank you.
Speed runs are not something you want to have when you're never mind.
Jake, Drew, have you guys seen any type of speed run ever?
Yeah, I mean,
I think I watched like a Mario Brothers speed run where they like use the warps and everything.
Yeah, one of the first ones that I remember watching where I was actually trying to, figure out how in the hell did they do that was a Final Fantasy on the NES speed run. And I'm pretty sure it was like completely glitched out because the guy just he did it in like 25 minutes. There was like no way that it was glitched out as hell.
Right, you'd be supplied. You su supplied. You'd be surprised.
Surprised?
Because
UHF?
yeah,
That's racist.
Sometimes there's because there's a difference between, in my mind, exploits and glitches. Exploit is just exploiting a bad, poorly made part of the game to do something you're not supposed to. Glitches are like errors in programming, and that's like the really extreme stuff. Like for example, in Contra 3 for the Super Nintendo. The way the game recognizes game over and the way the game recognizes completing a stage is the same thing. Basically, the screen fades to black. So what they do to skip stages is that they lose all their lives and they build up their point score right before they get a one up, right before they get another guy. So they dive into death, and before they die, they unleash one of the bombs. The bomb sweeps across the screen and kills everything, right? So as they're doing the death animation, they're dying, but they're getting points, so they get a one up, between the time they die and between the time that the character falls to the floor and actually dies,
What?
correct? So the screen starts to fade to black, and it's hard to follow, I know. It'd be best to show it to you, right? But the screen starts to fade to black because he died, right? But then at that point, the game checks if he had any one ups left, and it says, oh, he does have one up left. It must mean he got to the end of the stage, so it just throws him to the next
Oh my
level.
God.
So it's like, yeah.
Okay, you need to give us a video of this, and we'll link
This
it
is for
in the show
Contra,
notes
Contra
on the
3, Super Contra.
Yeah,
The Super C is
Super
2.
C.
The one on Super Nintendo is 3.
So yeah, Super Nintendo is Contra 3.
Wow.
Okay, yeah,
So
I kind of want to.
that speed run is basically him running back and forth from the beginning of the level. Because in Contra, they spawn
Right.
infinitely, right? They jump out of every nook and cranny, So he's building up his point score right before he gets a one up, and then he dives repeatedly, puts out the bomb, and he just skips to the next level.
That's
It's crazy.
What the hell?
Another
See,
one
I
is
would never figure that out.
He that
yeah,
had
I have no
I
idea how they figured it out. It's
probably an accident.
bewildering. Yeah, maybe.
Like they were about to die and that happened. It probably just happened randomly.
Or they
Right.
decompiled the code or something somehow.
Yeah, a lot of because the tool-assisted runs are the emulator ones, and a lot of times the legit speedrunners, they get ideas from them, because since they pick apart the game very mechanically in the emulators, they find secrets a lot of times before the people who run on the consoles. So there's always like borrowing back and forth between the two communities.
That's still it's crazy.
Yeah, another famous glitch is in the Ocarina of Time, which is it's called the Infinite Sword glitch, where you basically swing your sword in Zelda, and during the sword swing, you interact with something. You either talk to somebody, you read a sign, or try to pick something up, and then the game narrator like gets the memo that Link stopped swinging his sword. So even though Link is
Oh,
standing up straight, he's still attacking, like technically in the game, right? So he's basically he walks next to a boss, and the boss like dies in 2 seconds because he gets hit like a billion
oh
times in one
my
second.
God.
That's man.
I can see why
Yeah,
you're
it's
watching all
crazy.
these, David.
Yeah, so that's the difference. There are some of these that some people don't like the glitched runs, but I generally like the glitch runs more because I find them more interesting. Even though like even skillful play is still super interesting and impressive, but I like to see the way they pick apart these games and they use these glitches to like beat the game more efficiently. It's super crazy.
Well, it's just that extra little bit of something that you wouldn't normally get from, you know, I guess it's like something that, you know, a human can figure out, but, you know, if you programmed the computer to play against itself, it would never figure
it out. Yeah, that's probably a really good point. And you know, there's a huge community, right? So it's almost like a mob picking apart these games and trying to find the secret. It's cool.
So have you done any or tried to do any speedruns?
No, I at one point I tried to convince myself that I could do a speedrun, and maybe I can one, but I lost patience because most of our speedrunners have to have patience. They can speedrun a game for like a month, playing it every day for like 2 hours, and they don't get that one run they need. You know, the one that they execute all the tricks correctly, the one that they do everything in order, and the one where they don't get bad luck. It's a lot of factors in to make a good speedrun. Like the best speedrunners are probably the most patient speedrunners, really.
I'm surprised like you haven't tried like a Metal Gear speedrun or something, because I know you're a giant Metal Gear fan.
I have actually tried Metal Gear Solid 3, but then some other guy was doing it at the same time I was doing it, and he totally destroyed me. He's, you know, I think these people are on the next level, right?
So he crushed your spirit?
Yeah, basically, because it came on the, you know, they put it up on the website, and I watched it like, wow. That's like, I wasn't even doing half of this stuff. This guy is a beast.
Were you just walking around with your head hanging down after that?
Yeah, no, I was basically just... I was trying to be smart. I was like, oh, I'll throw magazines all over the place to distract the guards and just run past him, and you know, it wasn't quite working.
I've tried a speedrun once, but only for like a day. That was the Braid. What it was game? The Braid speedrun, because that's one of the achievements in Braid.
Oh yeah.
I was like, I could totally do this in 3 hours. Right, like, then I started doing it. I was like, nope, I totally can't do this.
Yeah, it's pretty impressive. You could go to Speed Demos Archive and watch the speedrun, and it'll basically be like a walkthrough of how to do it, how to get that trophy or achievement.
Chieves.
Oh, just a side note, Braid, going back to the subgenre thing I was talking about with Deer Escher, I would not put Braid in that subgenre at all.
Yeah, it sounds like Braid is
a game that tries to do a lot of art stuff through its game mechanics. Not what I was trying to say. Yeah,
right.
It's still a cool game.
Anything else about speedruns?
The last thing I'll mention is yearly now they're doing this speedrun marathon. I think someone posted about it in the message board, so to the community it isn't completely alien. But in case you don't know, there's a what's it called? I believe it's called Awesome Games Done Quick. It's basically like a telethon. They broadcast on the internet, and it's like 6 days. And they make more and more money every year for the Cancer Research Foundation. This year they made, I believe it was like 11, like I'm sorry, it was 111,000 something for cancer. It was crazy.
That's great.
Really fun, because they have like a split screen of the game on one side, and the other side the speedrunners who are playing, and they're constantly you know, talking about the game. They're explaining the tricks as they're doing it, and they're taking donations as they're doing it. There's donation wars. For instance, if they're going to play Zelda, and to name the file of the game, you could name, you know, you could put your name, right? But they start taking donations to like, so like I could donate, say, oh, name the game, name the file David, and I put $20. Someone puts $30 to name it Mark, then they win, right? So the donation wars, it's super cool. Crazy and super entertaining. And
for a good cause, sounds like.
Yeah, exactly. And you could go and watch all of them. They put it up, and you could download like how many hours that is. For in speeddemosarchive.com, it's crazy. I highly recommend it.
Yeah, I would. I've considered for, you know, several years, you know, doing like a marathon run of, you know, a set of, you know, Final Fantasy games or something, and, you know, doing, you know, streaming that online and doing that for charity. But I don't think someone wants to really watch me doing that.
Now, who knows?
Yeah, I've never really.
You'd be surprised.
I've never really had any interest in doing a speedrun.
Well, I wouldn't want to do a speedrun. I would just want to kind of, you know, marathon through it, or, you know, find out what maybe the Guinness Book of World Records record is for, like, you know, continuous gameplay by two people or something.
Right.
I don't know. That might be interesting.
Yeah, well, it's definitely interesting. If you're interested at all, the website is speeddemosarchive.com, and I guess we will put a few links in the
yeah, we definitely notes. Will
or in the on the pod or the forum post
on the pod post
on the pod post. start the store.
Oh boy. Anything else? Because otherwise, I think we should take a break. Hearing that noise was my first ever feeling. That's how it's been all around me. I'm all lost in the supermarket. I can no longer shop happily. I came in here for a special offer. A guaranteed personality. I'm all tuned in. I see all the programs. I save coupons for packets of tea. Okay, we are back. During the break, it's been pointed out, I was saying Dear Escher. It's actually Dear Esther. Sorry. I apologize.
I think you made me think it was the wrong one, and I said it wrong, too.
Same here.
I think I did. Sorry about that, Jake.
Your wrongness is like a plague spreading across all the podcasts.
We should really just apologize to Esther.
That's a little extreme, don't you think?
Nope. I think it's accurate, 100%.
Anyway, let's move on.
I think Totoro has something to say. Do you?
You mean Drew?
Drew, yeah.
Andrew? The Diary of Andrew?
Yeah. Well, speaking of speedruns, I had
My joke.
My wife brought home lunch today, and she picked up some Taco Bell, and she brought home the Dorito taco.
Oh, God, how was it?
And at this point, I was going to say, last time I was at Taco Bell, I got the speed runs, but now I can't do it.
It was, imagine a Dorito with taco stuff on it.
That's it? That sounds exactly right.
I don't know. I've been places where they do, like, nachos with Doritos, and I'm not a big fan of that because it's like, no, you've already got nacho stuff on the Dorito, you know, to make it taste like a nacho.
Have you heard of like the Frito taco things?
Like the walking taco?
Yeah, where you just have like a bag of Fritos and then they just put the taco stuff in the bag.
Yeah, that's fine. I'm cool with that.
It was just like that, but taco.
I can see that being good because I use Fritos in my chili.
Let's talk about Fritos.
Yeah, I really like Fritos.
Fritos are pretty good. They're good for scooping because of their shape.
Yes.
And they're little, and they're really crunchy. And it comes in a small bag, but there's always way more in there than you expect.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Well, it's like they're dense or something.
Yeah, they really pack them in there.
So that's it. We're just moving it. We're just transitioning away from the Dorito.
This episode brought to you by Fritos.
Well, I wanted to mention that in Chile, which I lived 2 years, they call burritos everything. Like, they don't differentiate between tacos and burritos, but they still have burritos and tacos over there, but they just call it burrito, you know? Like,
so when you order a burrito, it's a mystery what you're actually going to get?
Yeah, exactly. It depends on the menu, on the place. Like, they might bring the taco if you say a burrito, and it's really weird, and it's kind of... Next, and wait, is it a burrito or a taco? Like, both. Like,
what? Is that a cultural thing, or is that, like, a language thing?
I think they're just dumb. Sometimes.
Because they're dumb.
I don't mean to be mean or racist now that I live in the United States again. I'm not trying to throw them under the bus. I'm not one of them anymore. But sometimes...
But you're stupid.
Weird. Yeah.
Sometimes but you're just weird stupid, and you need to read a book.
There. Yeah, and the other thing I dislike about Chile, there's two things. One is the burrito and taco thing, and the other thing is that I never ate Fritos over there, but I did eat plenty of chips. And you know how when you open a bag of chips, it's never filled to the top? And you're it's kind of a ripoff. In Chile, it really is a ripoff. It's like halfway, less than halfway sometimes. It's crazy.
Did you ever buy a bag of chips and then take them back and say, what are you trying to pull?
No, because I just looked at it and said, oh my God, this is in America.
Did you just start reenacting Troll 2?
Oh my God. They're gonna eat me next. Another thing is everything over there is less flavorful, slightly. Like the Coca-Cola has less sugar, so that actually made Lay's chips a little bit more tasty to me. Cause I always thought they were too salty, but in Chile they have slightly less salt, so I kind of like them more. So that's my Chile segment.
Well, that's because everything here either has MSG or high fructose corn syrup in it.
It just tastes more extreme than over there. Things taste more diluted.
Back to the Taco Bell Dorito taco. Totoro? Or Andrew? Diary of Andrew?
I don't know that I would have another one.
Ever?
No.
You just prefer standard taco?
Taco, yeah.
Given your choice.
Despite how I don't like Taco Bell, I think I want to try it at least.
Yeah, give it a try once, but you know, I kind of would rather just go down to my local Mexican place and you know, get tacos from there. I'm getting ready to actually move from just north of Indianapolis down to around Louisville.
Yeah, that's Stalkers.
Yeah, so you can find me. But I'm gonna miss my local Mexican place. I've gotten a chance to know some of the guys who run that there, and they're good people, and they make really, really good food.
Well, I made, you know, the speedruns joke about Taco Bell earlier, but that's really not a joke. I really do not like Taco Bell. It always gives me an upset stomach.
Not me. I might have a stomach overload. I've only eaten Taco Bell a handful of times, probably less than 10 times in my life. And I'm always fine with it. I always end up eating like at least 2 chalupas and at least 1 burrito.
I would just rather go to Moe's or like Willie's or something and get a burrito. You guys have Moe's, right? You know what Moe's is.
Yeah.
I was about to ask, what the hell is that?
I just found out what Moe's is. My friend came and Moe's. My friend came and said, "Do you have Moe's near here?" Like, Moe's, what the hell is that? So no, I don't know what that is.
It's a burrito place. Well, they have more than just burritos, obviously. Yeah, but
they make really good quesadillas too.
Yeah, it's like this burrito has, you can get whatever you want on it, and it's with steak and stuff. It's really good.
I'm more of a Chipotle fan.
He wanted
myself
something from there. I forgot what it was. He described it to me. It sounded good, but I forgot what it was.
Chipotle, I don't like their steak. It's too spicy. I'm not really a big fan of super hot and spicy things.
Well, it's like, I don't know. It must be not much of a thing anymore, but or they must not be around quite as much, at least in my area, because the one that I used to go to when I was working on the north side of Indianapolis, like, closed.
Well, also, I'm sure this is the most entertaining thing ever to listen to, but mm-hmm. Chipotle is, they don't have queso, you know, melted cheese, and you have to buy the chips separate, and they just give you like 4 chips when you buy it for like $10. Yeah. Whereas Moe's, they give you a giant bag full of chips.
Yeah, and it's like getting the extra queso or whatever is not that expensive.
Yeah, and the queso is great.
Yeah, I've never heard of Moe's. I only heard of, besides Taco Bell, just Baja Fresh.
That's new. I have not heard of that. Qdoba also.
But yeah, after I go to Taco Bell, I mean, going to the bathroom then is scary for anybody that comes in after me. I mean, scary. Almost like an 80s horror movie or something.
I see what you did there. Nice.
Speaking of 80s horror movies, how do you guys feel about them?
Yeah, did you ever see, there was a 80s horror movie that had, on the cover of the box, actually had like a creature coming out of a toilet.
Ghoulies?
Ghoulies, yeah.
How do I know this? I haven't seen any 80s horror movies. I think it's because I used to work at a video store.
Yeah, could so be. Did I. Yeah,
Ghoulies. Ghoulies, there was Gremlins, and then that spawned all these little monster movies that had a bunch of little monsters. There was Ghoulies and Critters.
Yeah, I actually have like the first 2 Critters movies on VHS in my other room. I was just going through a bunch of old stuff that kind of once the video store that my parents owned shut down, stuff that I kind of took that wasn't selling.
And you know, Critters, one of the Critters single might be 2, it could be 4, I don't know. One, they have Leonardo DiCaprio in it.
Well,
is that
the main
his first role or something?
No, I think this was after he was on Family.
Yeah, Growing Pains.
Yes, thank you.
Family Pains.
With Boner.
Right, because Boner. Johnny Depp's first role was in, like,
Nightmare on Elm Street.
Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yeah.
So, that's one of my favorite horror movies. Actually, it's probably my favorite horror movie.
It's cool.
I kind of like some of the other ones when they start getting a little goofier, the later Nightmare on Elm Street movies.
Yeah, I would say 1, and then 3 is the other best one.
Now, I've not seen any of those in at least 15 years, probably.
1 I think holds up really well. 3 is just ultra campy, and 4 takes the camp to another level.
Now, I think it was 5, the one where I just remember watching this one, and this guy's smoking pot or something, and then he is watching TV and he falls asleep, and like Freddy comes through the TV, and then they start playing like Inagata Da Vida.
That is 6, Freddy's Dead.
6, okay.
That one takes the camp. I mean, it you are murdered with camp in that.
Yeah,
one.
Exactly. I'm lucky to be here.
Yes.
But yeah, that's I I really liked those when I was younger, but you know, once I kind of got a little bit older, it was like, oh, no,
Freddy
no more.
Was playing Nintendo with the Power Glove.
Oh yeah, I remember that.
And then he said, "Good graphics."
Sounds good.
But yeah, I always liked Freddy more than Jason.
Oh yeah, definitely. Well, and you know, kind of did the Friday the 13th movies, did those start back in the late 70s or?
I think it was like 81, I think, so, maybe. And the first one had Kevin Bacon in it.
Yeah, I was going to say, Kevin Bacon gets, spoilers, Kevin Bacon dies by having a arrow go through his neck after he bones some chick or something.
That is accurate. I think that had to be pre-Footloose.
Yeah, I think that was actually his... No, I take it back. The first movie that I think he ever did was Animal House, because he played Chip Diller in that.
That's right. But Footloose is definitely 80s horror, right?
As far as I'm concerned, I mean, because that John Lithgow is so damn creepy.
He's creepy in everything, though.
Yeah, you know...
Even Third Rock from the Sun.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I was going to mention The World According to Garp, which is a comedy with kind of a comedy. That's actually, now that I think about that movie a little bit, that's kind of depressing, but anyway.
But I guess it's, when was Alien, was that 79 or 80?
I'm going to say that was 79.
Okay, that is disqualified.
Yeah, and but plus, I think...
The sequel is an horror.
Yeah, it's an action movie.
One of the best, though. Arguably the best. I would say the best. I say it's better than Die Hard.
Well, and to me, you know, one of the things that kind of differentiates, like, the stereotypically 80s horror movies is that, you know, we kind of talked about it a lot with the Nightmare on Elm Street movies, is the camp.
Yeah, well, you can't really talk about 80s horror without talking about Night of the Creeps. Because Night of the Creeps is one of the best 80s horror camp fests.
Huh? I can't relate to this conversation at all, because I didn't watch horror movies growing up as a kid, because they would give me nightmares.
Night of the Creeps was the very first movie box pick, made by Bob.
Blah, blah, blah. Blah, blah.
Exactly.
I was not part of the forums at that time.
And that the one that was remade to Slither?
It was like, yeah, it's like Slither, yes.
Oh, okay, I saw Slither.
But... it's different. And the director went on to make Monster Squad.
I saw Monster Squad. That was a good movie.
And I believe it says, "Go Monster Squad," written in a bathroom in Night of the Creeps.
My wife approves of Monster Squad as well.
That's weird.
Your wife has good taste.
So he had a master plan.
Yes, she does.
The film we're going to make.
Yep. Night of the Creeps is so good, though. It has Tom... God, what's his name?
Bergeron.
No. What?
Selection.
Yes. It had him, yep. Not Tom Atkins, nope. Tom Bergeron. They start, you see the creeps, they play Hollywood Squares, and they always win.
And then they are doing America's Funniest Home Videos.
And it's Dancing with the Creeps.
Exactly. So what we're really saying here is modern reality TV is pretty much equal to 80s horror, campy horror movies.
Some of it, yeah, I would say so. Probably Jersey Shore.
I've gone back and seen a lot of 80s horror now that, you know, I'm older. But at the time, I didn't see them, so. Like, so, I have a friend who's totally into, like, 80s horror, and, like, he loves the Friday the 13th movies. And in college, I saw Jason Takes Manhattan, which is hilarious.
Wait, that's the one you started with?
Yes.
The one where it's basically really Jason takes a boat and then goes to Manhattan for 5 minutes and then goes into a sewer and gets washed away with toxic waste because that's what's in the sewer of Manhattan?
Yes.
Everyone knows that, right?
Wait,
Manhattan sewers filled with toxic waste.
I just like the scene with the boxer guy.
Yeah, didn't you?
Yeah.
It's so good.
Yeah, of course the sewers are filled with crap in Manhattan. Didn't you see Ghostbusters 2?
No, actual toxic waste. And then doesn't it turn Jason back into a kid or something?
Forget.
But yeah, the boxing scene was great. The guy is punching Jason in the face, who's wearing a hard hockey mask that would, like, break his hands.
Yeah, but it's hilarious.
And then he gets Jason right up to the edge of a building so they can knock him off, and then he gets too tired to hit anymore. And then he just says, "Come on, give me your best shot." And then one hit, the guy's head gets punched off.
Yeah.
It's hilarious. And, you know, I think I marathoned that movie back-to-back with Maximum Overdrive, which is also equally hilarious.
Well, you know who they directed remade that?
I do know who directed that. And you know who wrote it?
The same guy.
Yep, same guy. He writes things. Maybe you may have heard of him.
Steve. Uncle Stevie.
Steve.
I think they did remake that?
Yep. Stephen King directed it, by the way.
Is the remake any good?
It was I think it was a U.S. direct-to-USA movie. It's called Trucks.
That I remember that. Okay. In that, I remember when that came out on video.
I remember when he did the direct-to-TV version of The Shining.
Oh, God. Yeah, that was a miniseries. I mean, yeah. They just remade it as a movie.
With the guy from Wings.
Yeah, I was going to say, didn't have Steven Weber in it.
It did. And from what I hear, I haven't actually seen it. Everyone says that is much more faithful to the book than Kubrick's.
Kubrick.
I saw a little bit of it, and it seemed dumb and boring. I'm not
because in Kubrick's version, it was just, he basically just went crazy. There wasn't any actual real ghosts or anything. But yeah, in the book, there's actually ghosts.
Yeah, I think Stephen King kind of described it as, in his book, the evil is in the hotel, whereas in the Kubrick version, the evil is in Jack more than anything else.
Exactly.
Yeah, but at the end, some stuff starts popping up.
Or 80s horror.
Yeah, it is. We can talk about The Shining. Want to talk about The Shining?
That movie's great.
Here's Johnny.
I'm not going to hurt you, horror movies, but I love that movie.
All work and no play makes David a dull boy.
Really? I think most of the 80s movies I've seen actually have been recommended by Jake. You know, Mr. X, the one right in front of me.
Yep, I'm
there's
right
a lot
in front
of Stephen
you.
King from 80s horror.
Oh, yeah.
You gotta admit. Is Creepshow 80s?
Yep.
Yes.
And Creepshow 2.
Probably the one that scared
Children
me,
of the
though.
Corn.
Yeah. Probably the one of those that scared me the most, though, and still to this day scares me, and the book frightens me to no end.
Chopping Mall is
Pet Sematary. That one scares the shit out of me.
Wasn't that early 90s, though?
No. Pet Sematary 2 with Clancy Brown and Eddie Furlong.
If you want to talk about Clancy Brown, we can talk about some Clancy Brown. But I could go on forever about that. We should save that for later.
Shall we transition?
Yeah. Although Jar Fox brought up Chopping Mall, I just want to say, everybody, if you want to see a movie about a robot security guard killing teenagers that camp out overnight in a mall, watch Chopping Mall.
Yeah, I don't really like horror movies, but it was pretty fantastic.
It's so good.
It's all about the camp.
What would they say? The robots would say something. They'll be like, halt. They say something that they say throughout the whole movie.
Your move, creep.
I wish.
I forget, but
that would have made it better.
That's like another robot movie, Deadly Friend. Don't know if you guys have seen that. Deadly Friend. No. Before we were recording, we were talking about The Chase, and someone from The Chase is in Deadly Friend. What's her name?
Ray Wise?
No.
Christy Swanson?
That's it. She's the female lead. In that, there's a robot that is some guy's friend, and then Christy Swanson dies, so he takes the chip out of the robot and puts it in her brain, and then she becomes like the robot, but she starts killing everyone. And then the Fratelli mom from the Goonies,
Anne Ramsey, is that Anne Ramsey? No, I may have that wrong.
She throws a basketball at the Goonies lady's head, and the head explodes, and it is so funny.
Nice.
Oh yeah, but we should transition into the movie box pick.
Your movie box pick.
First one ever?
No. What? No?
Didn't you listen to last week's episode, David?
Yeah, but I thought that was just a... You didn't pick that one, did you?
Yeah, Douglas did. Or Mark did.
No. I did.
Okay, never mind. So it's the second movie box pick ever.
Of the week, of the month.
For the podcast, yes. Yeah, this one was ever. The Gate. The 80s classic, The Gate.
I think Drew has something to say about The Gate.
That movie is 85 minutes long.
I think that's accurate.
I thought it was good.
It is accurate. It's almost 86 minutes, which would make it.
Man, that movie is so 80s. Oh my god.
Yeah, Terry, the metal stuff that just, oh my god.
Yeah, also that girl who had the hairstyle that was like,
That was like from.
She had like a bang.
There's something
that
about
was
Mary.
Basically
like,
her.
Yeah, that was hilarious.
Yeah, I was like, why would Well, you
And then
know.
they randomly just put a purple streak in the one girl's hair.
Oh yeah, he asked her about it, right?
And it's like, what happened to your hair?
Yeah, that was weird. So that movie was kind of cool because it kept me guessing. I wasn't sure what type of movie it was, if it was like really hardcore or not.
Well, it's
Because,
PG-13.
right. So we're talking spoilers, obviously, of the film, right? I'll just go right into it.
Yep.
Yeah.
There's a scene where the kid with glasses, he falls into the hell hole. We're like, oh damn, he died. But then he crawls out. And he said, oh wait, so if he survived, everybody's gonna survive, you know, whatever. But then everybody dies. Like, what? But then everybody comes back to life. Like, oh, okay. So, like, the whole movie, I was kind of, you know,
The movie
because
was
of the.
playing with your emotions.
Yeah, exactly. I was a roller coaster ride. Sometimes, you know, I just kind of see a movie very academically. I don't really get into it. I'm like, oh, whatever, who cares? But this time, I was like, what's gonna happen? I actually didn't know what's gonna happen.
And the little kid in it was Steven Dorff.
Who's Steven Dorff? He looks
He
familiar. I've seen him somewhere else.
was the bad guy in Blade, the first
Yeah,
Blade
he's been
movie.
in all sorts of shit.
Really?
He
But like
also did Cecil B. Demented.
Yeah,
he
and
was in other films as a kid or not?
I don't know. I only know his work
'Cause
as an
he looked
adult.
familiar as a little kid.
Maybe you just recognize him as an adult, but shrunk to a little kid?
I got some good eyes.
I guess.
So, I can say that this film was okay, but I just enjoyed a lot of the 80s schlock that was in it thoroughly. It was a trip down like memory lane.
Well, yeah, you kind of get the whole satanic panic type thing going on. Not necessarily that they had the panic, but going with the heavy heavy metal will open up the doorway to hell.
Yeah, and playing it backwards will give you a secret message.
It's the
Yeah.
camp, right? The camp is the good part, but at the same time, it's also ridiculous.
But how is it they found two geodes like 2 feet underground in their backyard?
Hey, it's a geode, a thunder egg.
Come
Yeah,
on.
the beginning progresses really quickly, and I was like, "What? Huh?"
Yeah, it opens with like a dream sequence.
Yeah.
And then it shows like the kid in the treehouse that got struck by lightning and fell over.
It was like
But
a
then
premonition of things to come.
and then he wakes up and the tree was down and everything, but was the tree was it down before that? It doesn't, I
No,
mean,
it got
and
hit by
how
lightning
quickly
that
did they?
night.
Well, then how in the hell did they get the crew out
Yeah,
to do that that quickly?
there's a crew out taking care of the tree right then. There's no way that could happen.
Listen, man, they worked without lunch. They got it.
Maybe
What?
they would. There's no way unless they owned the tree hauling company.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe.
Well, and every time I see like a kind of a horror movie with a kid, thinking about or dreaming about like a scary tree or something, it always makes me think of Poltergeist. So, and actually, when I was watching it earlier, and I was kind of talking to you guys, I was like, I think my exact words were, "Okay, I'm gonna go watch this movie, not Poltergeist."
It's not Poltergeist.
I
Yeah,
know it's not.
there was
That's the
some
point.
effects, like the wall was pulsating, that kind of reminded me of Poltergeist a bit.
That reminded me of a scene from Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yeah,
Yeah,
kind of.
that's a, I guess it's kind of a common effect to have like plastic and then push somebody's face through the plastic and make pretend it's a wall or something.
What'd you guys think of those little monsters that
The
showed up
Chihuahua
later?
demons? The Chihuahua
Yeah.
demons?
They were little demons.
What'd you think of it when the guy with the teeth, the little kid with the teeth, stepped on the one and it started freaking out, like vibrating?
I was
Yeah,
wondering
it was
exactly.
hilarious.
I thought he was gonna actually like squish it, but then he didn't. It just started moving, going crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was expecting a splat and a lot of like purple juice, but he just stepped on it like
Right.
twice and it started like I don't know, break dancing or something.
Exactly. Well, and then I love that, because they're out there, they're trying to close the gate and they're reading from the Bible. And, this kid falls down and, goes through, he finds all these little monsters down there. And he starts climbing back up, and one of the other kids starts reading from the Bible again. He's yelling up, "Glenn, stop it. You're making them mad." As
And
if,
the hole
it's.
was, he was saying that it was closing on him too. And he kept reading.
Yeah,
It's
I
like,
wouldn't. I
well,
was like, fuck you.
it's fuck you.
Can I close
Yeah,
the
we.
hole?
Hey man, the good of the many outneed the good of the few.
Did you
Or the
guys think
needs of
the
the many
movie,
outweigh.
did you think the movie was gonna be over when the gate, when the hole closed up?
Hell no.
I thought it would, but then I had seen the runtime like a few minutes before when I paused it to do something, and I knew there was plenty more movie to go, so.
Yeah, so then you were surprised by the guy that came out of the wall.
I wasn't surprised, but I thought it was random. But then I remembered that he was telling tall tales, the kid with glasses,
Yeah, he's like, "I just
and it
made it up."
manifested. Yeah, it manifested into life. The thing about the film I found interesting, it's a little bit after that, was when the King Demon guy comes out and he lifts up the main character kid, and he doesn't kill him, he just pats him on the head and leaves like an eyeball on his hand. They don't really explain what it was, but I guess that he was just like the first slave or something.
He just had an eyeball in his hand.
Well, and
It was a gift.
if you look at the markings in blood on the wall that appear, there's actually a hand with an eye in the palm.
Yeah, because I.
If you missed that.
But why is that bad? Wouldn't you just
I
be able to
have.
like stick your hand around a corner to see things?
Because I think it's his eye. I think it's Demon's eye watching him all the time or
Yeah, exactly.
something.
It's kind of like the eye of Sauron or some shit.
So,
I
because
see.
when he patted his head, I thought, like, okay, he saw the goodness in him with the good power that he was talking about. So the kid won automatically. He's gonna go back into hell. They won. But then he looks outside and he sees hell coming out and he's like, okay, I don't get it. But then I guess it was, it's just part of living in the demon world. You got eye in your palm.
Yep. And that movie loved rockets.
Oh yeah.
Oh God, remember those rockets?
I do. When I was
I
in high
don't.
school, we did in my one of my science classes, we had a science project where we had to send a rocket up, and mine went up so high that we never found it again.
I actually
You caught the
have
forest
one that
fires.
I kind of gave my nephew, my 8-year-old nephew. Well, he's 9 today, but I gave him a model rocket and told him that we'll shoot it off this summer.
Just a bottle rocket?
No, like a model rocket.
Oh, model. I thought you said bottle rocket.
No, model rocket.
Okay, that's better. Because
Yeah.
a bottle rocket would not be exciting.
No.
That'd be a total
No.
letdown.
I'll get one of the little Whistler ones that's like nothing.
That would be great.
It's like, here you go,
So,
kid. But,
I'm sorry, but I know you guys are dog lovers in here. How do you feel about
yeah.
the asshole guy treating the dog's lifeless body like, I don't know, like luggage
Yeah,
or something?
everyone was treating that dog like crap in the
Yeah,
whole movie.
exactly. I was like, why are you taking it to animal control? There's nothing to control. The animal has died.
And the
It
dog
has
just wanted to
left
be,
the building.
the dog just wanted to be pet by that the best friend.
Yeah.
And then he was like, "What
Yeah.
is your dog doing?" And he starts like pushing it away, and talking about how it stinks.
It's
Yeah,
97 years
exactly.
old.
Well, see, I thought that maybe the stink thing, maybe he started to smell like death or something. I don't know.
I think that was just a coincidence, maybe.
Oh, and then there
But.
was the levitation scene,
Oh yeah,
which
I
was.
hated how the kid reacted to being levitated, because it's one thing if you levitate out on the street, you go up so high and you're gonna fall down and die, right? But you're in your living room, I'd be like, fuck yeah, I'm levitating. And he starts crying.
And
Well,
then
he
he
cries because
grabbed
he
onto the
falls.
and then he grabs onto that lamp on the way down.
Yeah. And then you see like all of this kind of electrical cable come out, and it's like, why in the hell is there that much extra, material back there?
And then all the older teenagers start making fun of him for crying, even
Yeah.
though they just levitated him and then he grabbed onto a live electrical wire.
Yeah, and dropped like 10 feet.
Yeah, and say the F word a lot, not the fuck, but the other one to discriminate gay
Oh,
people.
that was so funny when he said
Oh.
that in the kitchen scene. He's
Yeah.
walking away, he's just like, fag.
Yeah, I didn't expect it
Yeah,
because
that was.
I guess that wasn't such a cuss word back in the 80s.
That was
But
in
Well.
Monster Squad too.
Was it? I don't remember.
Yeah, it just
Well,
made me
yeah.
laugh because it reminded me of like this was a different time period.
Right, and then when
Yeah.
the two of them are going through, when Glenn and Terry, the two kind of main characters, are going through one of the closets. And then the sister and her two bitchy friends come in there and accuse
Oh
them of
yeah.
quote unquote fagging off. And I was like, what in the
Yeah.
hell, man?
Yeah, it's hilarious. Oh, and one thing I noticed about this movie, it's just it there are almost no adults. The entire
Yeah,
movie stars
yeah.
kids.
Well, yeah, there was the two adults and then they left. It was the two parents and then they left. So the kids were all home alone for 3 days.
Right, aside of the people cutting down the tree, the two parents were the only two adult actors, I think.
Well,
Yeah,
and
I think
the
so.
parents in the
Yeah.
movie were really worried because this was the first time they were going to be left home alone, and
Yeah,
they
for 3 days.
completely destroyed the house.
Yeah, they only tell literally. I guess that's the joke of the movie or whatever.
I think it is.
Yeah.
I mean, in
Well, and
general,
then.
it was kind of interesting because you could tell like, they're kids, so you gotta give them like a break when it comes to some of their performances. I thought Stephen Dorff did a really nice job until the end, the very end, where he was like, "Take me instead, take me instead, take me instead." It was bad. That was bad.
He did the same thing and he said, "It's all my fault. It's all my fault." It's all my fault.
Yeah, his performance was uneven. Some was very good, some was, you know, bad.
Well, that's probably his first acting job. Maybe.
Probably a monk, kid. Though, yeah.
Is he somebody famous? Cause...
No.
Who? The best friend?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, Lewis Tripp. Interesting thing, one of the last things that he was in was actually the sequel, The Gate 2.
Yeah, I was going to bring that up.
And did you... So you've watched that one?
I have.
That was really... It's been about 16 or 17 years since I've seen that movie.
It's probably been longer for me.
It's, yeah, because it came out in 90, so it's, you know, it's 22 years old at this stage. But I, you know, basically the premise of that movie is that after all of the stuff and that happens in this one, Glenn and Al and their family move away, but he's still there, but he gets into this really occult shit.
Yeah, and they capture one of those little... demon yeah. monster things.
Chihuahua demons.
And then yes. they can basically get like whatever they want.
Yeah, like making wishes with it.
Yeah, exactly. So, but I remember something vaguely about like certain like stuff turning to shit.
Literally, yes.
Yeah, literally turning to shit. Like, yeah, they wish for this car or something and it starts to turn to shit and they're blowing their nose with $100 bills, but like when they're, you know, when what would normally be mucus coming out of your nose, it like comes out as shit.
And they had like a big giant room full of all the stuff they got for free that they wished for, and then they just have big giant piles of it. I remember vaguely that movie, and I remember liking it.
The sequel sounds better than the original, then. I don't know.
It's, yeah, because, I mean, he's like 3 years older, so, you know, he's...
But he's like a teenager then, and he's got like long hair, I remember, and like a leather jacket.
Yeah, that does not say Killer Dwarfs on it.
It doesn't, and he's supposed to be like a rebel or something.
Right.
Right.
But I think he like winds up with a girl at the end of that movie.
With Al? Wow.
No. they moved away in the second movie, but anyway, But no, that's 90s horror movies.
Okay, I was going to mention that kid's kind of, that's, I don't know, I think that's out of character for that kid, because... He lived through the almost apocalypse. I don't think he'd be taking those Chihuahua demons so lightly, just tying them up and asking him for wishes. I think he'd take him to a priest and say, exterminate this the most safe way possible or something.
Yeah.
That's my opinion, I think.
All right, I guess that's going to wrap up The Gate then.
Yeah, I think it might.
Yeah, it was okay. I like it.
Yeah, it was much far better than Red State.
Oh, so much better.
But I wouldn't call it like a great movie either.
No.
The part I enjoyed the most is
for what it is and what it was trying to do.
Yeah. I enjoy the camp.
Yeah. Well, and the best line of the movie for me was, "You've been bad."
Right. Which time?
Either.
So the first time.
Or the phone call. I think the phone call was the best.
Yeah, because you're not expecting it, but then all of a sudden, "You've been bad."
That was great.
But, yeah.
Okay, so, next week's pick.
Yes.
Yeah, next week is my pick, and so I'm going to try and take it up a notch. And next week we're going to be watching American Splendor with Paul Giamatti.
Ooh, it's fancy.
It sounds like Mark convinced you to pick that one.
Well, I was talking about it last week because we were actually, and I'll talk about this more next week, but we were talking about like names and stuff, and this is kind of an autobiographical thing because American Splendor is kind of autobiographical, but the guy's name is Harvey Pekar, and you know he has this monologue in the movie that you'll see where he's like, "My name is Harvey Pekar," and he kind of goes on this little thing there.
Spoilers.
About names. Spoilers. But anyway,
it's a good movie.
It is a great movie.
I always get that movie mixed up with Ghost World.
This is probably easily one of my top 10 favorite movies of all time.
Really?
Yes. So, that's high praise.
And what's the name of it again?
American Splendor. Unfortunately, this one I don't think is on instant streaming, but you should be able to get it on DVD.
Right.
Yeah, I just checked. It is not on streaming.
Right, I was going to ask that to be sure, because I thought one of the rules going forward was that the films need to be on streaming, but that's just a suggestion.
It is preferred if they're on streaming, but let's give Drew a pass.
Yeah, because this is a really, really good movie.
Okay, but so if you can, try Netflix streaming.
Yeah, I mean, obviously. So, but that's it.
So, going from the gate, I guess now we're going to be moving on to Walking Dead talk.
Yeah, yeah. We're just gonna do a wild speculations about the finale. We're recording this podcast on the Saturday before the finale, so we're just gonna spend 10 minutes talking about what we think.
We'll talk about a little about the last episode leading into it, just for some context. So there will be some spoilers, major spoilers probably.
Yeah, and yeah. if we're kind of, you know, taking from that point on, you know, just assume that if, you know, it's going to be spoiler ridden from here on out.
Yeah, it's all spoilers.
All right, let's start.
So Shane died.
Yes,
and then Shane died again. I thought it was bullshit the way they killed him.
Carl should have killed him.
It wasn't the little kid?
Agreed, Jake, that you thought it was bullshit the way that he got killed off?
Yeah, it was dumb.
He was lame.
I mean, he should have died. He was a terrible character, but it's just Carl should have killed him. It's like they were setting it up for that, and then they chickened out.
Who couldn't right. then?
Well, did you ask who killed him?
Yes, sir.
Rick.
Actually, I should mention that I haven't seen the latest half season. I saw the first episode.
Have you read the trades, so you know the story?
I've only read the first trade, but I'm fine with spoilers. Don't worry.
Rick killed him.
Yeah, Rick kills him. Basically, they get this prisoner when they go into town to get Herschel, and they come back, and you know they find this guy, and they keep him up, and they're trying to figure out what to do with him. Guy's name is Randall.
Yeah, so. And then they're gonna let him go, but Shane doesn't want to let him go. So Shane makes it look like he escaped, but he actually killed him.
Yeah, he snaps his neck in the middle of the woods.
Yep, and then they made the mistake of bringing Daryl with their tracking party. Because
yeah,
Daryl knows how to track. I mean, what was he thinking? Exactly. That was so dumb.
Yeah, it seems to me, you know, especially over the past season, you know, he's gotten, you know, progressively, you know, dumber and dumber. He doesn't really think about his actions at all.
Shane, yeah.
No, the problem with Shane was they killed off Daryl.
Or no, they didn't kill off Daryl.
Merle.
No, not Daryl. Dale, sorry.
Dale.
They killed off Dale. So I figured if they killed off Dale, they're going to keep Shane around as his replacement.
But yeah.
Did you think that too, Jake?
No, I was thinking that Shane was going to make it to the last episode.
The finale. Because,
so you thought they were going to kill him this week, tomorrow.
Yeah, but they killed him this weekend, and now it looks like they're going to have to leave the farm after next episode.
I don't know about that.
I just thought it was lame. Maybe they didn't want to have, like, a kid shooting an adult on a televised TV show.
That would have been hardcore.
Well, I think, but if you go back to, like, the first episode, like, the one of the very
happened
first
on the
scenes,
Wire.
And The Wire was HBO.
That was HBO.
But one of the things was, like, one of the very first scenes is Rick shooting the zombie girl. Just
that
like,
is the first scene,
out.
Yeah.
But they don't show it.
Yeah, they do.
Yeah, they do. They show it directly.
Wait, Rick did they?
They didn't around with that.
No, in the pilot, they intended to show like a hole through her head.
Mm-hmm.
She was infected. She was a walker.
But for this episode that's going to be tomorrow, I'm thinking some more characters are going to die.
Yeah, who knows where they're going to go with this.
Maybe they'll get rid of T-Dog.
Yeah, who has done absolutely nothing this entire season.
Who's T-Dog, the black guy?
Yeah, he got cut in the first episode, and that was the end of his story. Well, no, he got sick. Because he got infected.
Because he got...
He's just there.
He's an extra.
He's like the other members of the Herschel family.
Who's the guy from the comic who had the hammer?
I can't.
You,
I don't remember.
Oh, God. Therese.
I think it's yeah, that sounds right.
Or something like that. I don't remember.
They should have. Why didn't they just have him? He was so much better.
Well, doesn't that technically happen later?
That should have happened already.
Oh, really?
He was at the farm.
I don't know.
Now I'm thinking they're gonna bring in Michonne, or however you pronounce her name.
But that's all comic. Your thoughts. Wait, before we speculate further, that's your thoughts about the finale, Jake, is that, like, more people are going to die?
Yeah, I think they're going to die, and then they're going to leave the farm, because it's going to be overrun. They have to. There's so many zombies there.
Yeah, Shane alerted the horde.
Yeah, he was a boomer.
I got a question. You said Dale died? Who was Dale, the old guy?
Dale is the old guy. They killed him off in the second The third to last episode. It was really lame.
Yeah, the
a walker.
So they killed the moral compass and the immoral compass?
Yeah.
So they're even. Don't worry.
Kind of on the Dale thing, I kind of feel like because that actor Jeffrey DeMunn is in so many Frank Darabont productions, I kind of half wonder if he didn't ask to be killed off and let off the show.
After Darabont left.
After
he was also in the Blob remake. He was the sheriff in the Blob.
Well, he was also in Shawshank Redemption, The Green Mile, probably The Mist.
He was Andrea was in The Mist.
But anyway,
I just thought it was lame.
I wonder
that,
if that's why that went down.
That Rick kills Shane, then Shane becomes a walker, and then Carl kills the walker. Shane.
Well, I mean, people have been upset about Shane becoming a zombie without being bit.
But the same thing happened to Russell.
That happens in the mythology of like the series.
That is from the comics.
Yeah, yeah.
And didn't they say something about that in the last season when they went to the CDC? He said the virus went airborne or whatever.
I forget. First season finale, I blocked it out. I don't remember much.
But if that was the case. Well, if the virus goes airborne, you know, close proximity of them, like, quote unquote, breathing on you would infect you.
Well, yeah, everyone is infected. It's just you have to be dead for it to take effect. And
if you get bit, then it infects immediately.
Yeah, because you're being bit by a dead thing full of all sorts of crazy bacteria that's biting you.
Which is what happened to that one guy.
Precipitates the process.
Was it Jim?
Yeah.
From season one, yeah, but. Yeah, I would agree with you that some people are going to die. I think some people are Herschel Farm are going to die, but I don't think Herschel himself will die.
I don't think his daughter will either.
Yeah.
I think his daughter will.
Really?
Yeah, I can just see that happening. I can see it completely. I can see them just completely crushing Glenn. I don't know why. I hope it doesn't happen like that because I think, you know, between Daryl and Glenn, I think those are my two favorite characters on the show.
Huh.
Yeah, I'm worried they're gonna kill Daryl.
No, oh my god, Daryl's so good. Daryl's like the best thing about like the TV series.
I hope that now that Shane is gone, that Andrea will start like acting like Andrea from the comics.
What, normal?
Yeah, well, more
Andrea
serious.
From the comics is very different.
Yeah, she is. She's not psycho, really.
Like psycho Shane.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's why I thought they were gonna keep Shane around longer, especially when they killed Dale off.
But what do you guys think is going to happen next episode?
Well, I was thinking that actually wouldn't it be a complete and total mindfuck if instead of, you know, Shane dying, if Shane killed Rick. So that was what I was thinking was going to happen. But I don't know. To me, it's so hard telling. I don't have the context of the trades and of the comic
books. So wait, did you like Shane more than Rick?
No.
Because some people actually did.
Those people are what I like to call wrong.
Those people are the people who like Kira more than L in Death Note. They're crazy people.
Oh yeah, that's you know yeah. L is by far better than Light. But anyway,
I have no idea what you guys are talking about.
We need to wrap this up. We're gonna reach 10 minutes soon.
Yeah.
Drew, your final thoughts. You were saying.
Yeah, shit's gonna happen. I would say people are gonna die, but I don't think it's gonna be anyone too significant. Maybe they'll kill
Herschel's family members. I think. You think they're gonna kill Lori?
I think they could.
No.
And I hope they do. She's super annoying.
Well, yeah, she's supposed to be annoying.
Can I make a prediction?
Yeah.
Can I make a prediction? And even though I don't know what's happened in the last few episodes.
Sure.
Somebody's gonna die. They're gonna be like lying on the ground, getting eaten by zombies, and then they're gonna look up at the sky and see the helicopter. And then, dun, dun, and then it's there.
Lost.
Well, they had a helicopter in the first episode or the second.
Yeah, that was the wild goose chase that they keep doing. That's the hope they have out because he saw the helicopter. So there's some sense of.
Then the helicopter could lead to the place that's after the farm. Try not to spoil it.
Does it start with a? I have an idea where the story goes, but I have no idea, you know?
You haven't read it?
Actually, wait a second. Let me put it in the chat.
No, no.
Well,
Don't spoil it for Totoro or Drew.
Well, I know they've said that they're moving towards Fort Benning, but, you know, I didn't know if they were going to continue on that path.
Well, we will see, and we got to wrap up because it's been 10 minutes.
Yes.
Okay, I want to, if I can, I just want to end with a joke that my father-in-law told me.
Is it about speed runs?
No, it's about The Walking Dead.
Okay.
And so if Herschel gets bit and he turns, does he then become Herschel Walker? It's funny because Herschel Walker was a football player. Never mind.
I don't get it.
I didn't know who he was.
Can we insert a cricket sound in here?
Explain.
cricket.
You need to explain the bad joke to make Mark groan, and then the joke redeems itself. Okay. And you have to start it with, you see.
You see, Mark, it's funny because Herschel Walker was a football player.
Success.
Can we end this, please?
Can I get an inner high five from you, Jake?
You just did.
Awesome.
Fuck you guys. All right, we're ending this.
Hell yeah.
So next week we're going to talk about the finale.
Well, yeah. Let's talk about the whole series, and that way we can compare it to the trades and everything.
Okay.
Let me read my ending notes. All right, thanks for listening to this episode. Thanks to David, aka Darfox8, for joining us this week, along with special guest Tumble. If you enjoyed this podcast, please donate to the official Geekbox Mumble server, where we record this and also where we hang out all week long talking about different things. If you want to participate in this podcast, you can send a PM to me, Dakazoo, or Totoro, or Mr. X on the Geekbox forums at forums.geekbox.net. And make sure you listen to the other podcasts like Geekbox, Comic Conspiracy, Comedy Button, and Good Job Brain.
And I'll talk Watch These Tokens.
Yes. Don't forget to check out our Twin Peaks podcast if you want to listen to that.
And you should want to, it's great.